Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. It's finally starting to feel like fall here, and I am living for it. If you're new here, hi, my name is Katie, and I am a nerdy flute player, which means I do covers of video game, anime, TV, film, music, all things of that nature. And if that sounds interesting, I will leave a link up in the cards to all of my cover song music videos, as well as links in the description below that has all of the streaming services where you can find my music. And there's more streaming than there is music videos, so definitely check all of that out. I am also a Twitch streamer over on twitch.tv/KatieShesko, where I do video games such as Breath of the Wild bingos, which I will leave link in the cards to what a Breath of the Wild bingo is, as well as things like Nier and Board Game Nights, which is also streamed here on YouTube. I will leave links to all of my social media below so you can come interact with me. And yeah, let's dive into today's video. Today's reaction is going to be Jethro Tull's My God, Nothing Is Easy, live at the Isle of Wight in 1970. This was a highly requested one in my comment section of some of my other Jethro Tull videos. So yeah, let's dive into this. Before I get started, if you are interested in seeing me react to just the studio versions, please leave a comment below. I've had some people say that they like the studio versions, some people like the live version. So let me know what your preference is in my comment section. But for now, let's go ahead and dive in. What I will do is we will watch the video in its entirety. I will give my initial comments and reactions as it's playing, and then we'll go back and then we'll do a deep analysis from there. So let's go ahead and get started.
My God. This is actually the beginning.
Loving the guitar riff so far. So I'm assuming that this is Ian. And if it is, amazing guitar playing. Loving the chords and the very like raw guitar strumming. It's I like how we're going back between like heavy strumming and like kind of this plucking. I love the juxtaposition.
So lean upon him gently and don't call on him to save.
That was a very violent throw. Okay, so I was right. He's holding the flute, so that's Ian. It's hard to tell sometimes when, like, the live concerts are back and forth. They change the look so often. There he goes, twirling the feet again. I like the duo tones. There he goes, playing on that one foot.
Oh,
So I'm like really studying his fingerings. Wow. I love incorporating the sound as part of the musical composition. And then the key smacks. Oh, I love it. Wow. I like that buzzing quality. That. So to hear the flute with everything, oh, love it. I love how now we're kind of getting some more of the traditional flute sounds.
And the grave an image Catholic.
I then did go right into singing as if it's nothing, of course.
With his plastic crucifix.
Oh, the outfits are just so 70s and I love it. Ooh, I like that transition.
Thank you.
Ooh, doing those low notes, that pinky workout is so hard. Oh, to have that dynamic contrast, so hard to do when you're doing these techniques.
A good cue, which is
takes me back to my marching band days. That was delightful. I really liked how he did some of those extended techniques that we've talked about in other videos, as well as kind of more just like traditional flute playing. I liked how it went back and forth. It's a really neat effect when you're kind of going back and forth. You kind of have like that classical flute sound with like this more modern flute sound. So well done. He loves to stand on one foot. That's impressive because it is hard to keep your balance and then still have a good like body alignment for flute playing. The flute is a very temperamental instrument where like any minor adjustments, any like minor changes to how the flute is sitting on your face can really affect the sound, and not always in a good way. So to do all while standing on one foot, and he did a lot of it in this particular video, that is hard. It is hard to do. I think the furthest I've got is just like playing in high heels, which is challenging. I've done high heels on very difficult terrain. It's very challenging. And I wasn't even performing live. I was doing it for a music video. So if the flute didn't sound quite so good there, it doesn't matter because I was using the studio version anyway. Wow. So let's go back and let's like deep dive analyze this. So how I typically do my reactions is I watch the full video in first, and then I go back and I will do a lot of pausing. If that is not your cup of tea, I completely understand, but I really want to deep dive into this. There's a lot to talk about. But because I watch the videos in full, I do tend to get copyright claimed, and I am not monetized on YouTube. So if this content interests you, please consider supporting me over on patreon.com/KatieSchesko. There will be a link in the description. For as little as $2 a month, when reactions are done, I put them early for all of my patrons. You get monthly updates. You get to see what reactions are coming up. I might start throwing a poll up there for what reactions you want me to do next. Patrons will have priority for the suggestions. Higher tiers also appear at the end of the video as credits, as well as the $15 tier gets backtracks to all of my songs that I produce. So if you are a flute player and want to play along, or if you're any instrumentalist and want to play along to my backtracks, those are available on my Patreon as well. And if a monthly donation is not your thing, please consider supporting me on Ko-fi. Link will be in the description below if you just want to, you know, buy me a coffee and support me getting an alto flute so I can offer different sounds to my songs. So now that that's out of the way, let's dive in.
My God. This is actually the beginning.
So I didn't recognize this as Ian at first because the couple of videos, his look has definitely changed over the years. I assumed that it was Ian, but I don't know. You never know. I feel like, you know, in this era, the 70s and the 80s, like, looks of people changed so dramatically. And I love that. As someone who likes to, well, the most dramatic I got was I cut my hair in college and now I dye it fun colors. Other than that, my look isn't too dramatic. I can't really tell, but it's like a purple, red, and orange, but this lighting does not do it any favors. Definitely changed the look. Love it. I was really excited to see that he's playing guitar. And I know people have mentioned in my comment section that he didn't think that he was a very good guitar player, which is why he decided to pick up the flute. And here it just proves that he is a good guitar player. So I talked about this in another one of my reactions about like playing repeated notes and repeated like phrases like that. I find that really challenging. Maybe it might be a little bit easier on guitar, but for me as a flute player, if I have to do like the same group of notes over and over and over, I tend to get like finger tied. It's really, I think someone else also commented that they also get, they have troubles with repeated sections. So I definitely don't feel alone, but doing that is really tricky to like, if you're going for it to sound exactly the same every time, that is really hard to do and to keep consistent. It's really easy for it to like, to sound different. And if you're going for the uniformity there, it's really hard to accomplish that. And then I like how he's going between like this plucking and the strumming. And I like right at the end of this phrase right here, he kind of had like this minor chord and it was just like a nice juxtaposition between like the plucky, the happy plucking, the da 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 da, and so on, to like this minor chord strum. I really like it. Yeah, this is just so pretty. Ian says he can't play guitar.
What have you done?
So I will stop right here and real quickly just say, I'm not going to really delve into the lyrics. I feel like the lyrics could probably be its own separate video of delving into the meanings and the symbolism and all of that behind that. So, and because I don't know the lyrics, this is the first time I've heard this song. It's not something I'm really going to touch on too much in this video, because like I said, I feel like that can be an entire video in itself. But I really like how the song starts off with just a nice little guitar solo, and then it's like this, you know, acoustic version of just guitar and Ian singing. And yeah, I really like how it starts, and then we definitely pick up later. And I like songs that do that. I do that frequently in my own rearrangements. I know I've mentioned this in other videos, but I like when songs do that. It just, it adds so much interest. It doesn't sound, pardon the pun, one note the entire time. I'll take my lashings in the comment section for my bad pun.
Him resurrected from the grave. From the grave. He is the God of nothing.
And again, I like this, like the slow strumming compared to the fast strumming. Yeah, I like how, you know, between the sections, he's going between like slow strumming and fast strumming. I really like those juxtapositions. Again, it gives the song some dimension. It gives it some interest. It doesn't make it sound so similar the whole way through. I love it. It just gives it a very spooky, interesting quality. Loving the 70s
so
outfits.
Lean upon him gently, and don't call on him to save.
So yeah, that like sudden violent thrusting of the guitar like startled me when it first came in. It surprises you, and I like that, especially with things that this would have been fantastic to see live, because like that's a very theatrical thing. Obviously you're not doing that in the studio. Like if you're gonna be transitioning between stuff like that, like you probably have somewhere gentle to place it, or you might even stop and then pick it up. I think more back in the day, like things were done all in one take. I could be wrong. I don't know much about recording history. I don't really know much about how things were recorded back in the day or how things were recorded as a band. I am a one-woman show. I do everything here in my studio. Literally right behind me is where I set up to record. And I have, you know, my backtracking is all sample instruments. I do not have live performers. It's just not in my budget. But that's the great thing about technology, is it allows me to do what I do and produce music without having to hire musicians. And I would love to get to a point one day where I could hire more live musicians, for sure. For the reality is I record by myself, so I'm sure how I would record is very different from how a band would record in a studio. I mean, this is, it's just solid. It's solid storytelling. This is a really interesting freeze frame. It's just, it's solid storytelling to music. I really like that. You don't really hear that a whole lot in popular music today. I love this kind of music. I don't listen to enough of it. I do like this kind of modern folk quality to Jethro Tull. It's, you don't really hear much of this stuff nowadays, and I'm really enjoying it. As someone who enjoys folk music, as someone who kind of enjoys bards and the nerdy things like that, there's a reason why I call myself the nerdy flute player. So like, to kind of have like this 70s rock to it is, it's really cool. It's really interesting, and I'm really enjoying it. So here, I like how he just like has these little blips of flute here and there. I mean, obviously he does the solo. I don't know if that solo is particular to the studio recording or if this was only a live thing. That's kind of the cool thing about live music, is you can kind of change up your solos in between. You know, it gives the audience something different. And that's why I like live music, because then, you know, like, especially back then, like, these performers like knew what they were doing. They were very competent as musicians, and I just love live performances, because in the studio things can sound a little bit more robotic. In the studio, like, you can kind of, you know, fix your mistakes, and you can have several takes at something to get something just right. And just live performance, you're really in the moment, and you know, those little flips and flubs sometimes just add character to the performance. And I say flips and flubs, like, not as a negative, like, they don't know what, like, they're playing, but it just, that's just the beauty of live performance, and it just adds so much character. And yeah, I love live music. It's been too long since I've been to a live concert. It's 2021, and I haven't been to one in so long. Soon. Okay, so before he gets into the solo, like, I loved the transition into this section. This just is showing how much the rest of the band are just fantastic musicians as well. And he's, again, twirling the flute around. I have been told that he probably he tapes his head joint and his foot joint on, and he probably doesn't use the most expensive of flutes. But, like, as someone who only owns, like, two good flutes, it's just that initial visceral reaction of, oh my gosh, like, I could just see a head joint flying off. Obviously, he takes precautions, but when you're seeing that, it's that first gut reaction of, oh my god. But it makes for such a good performance. It makes for such a good performance, and he's such a showman, and that's what you love to see in live music. So here we go. I try to pause it at a phrase. The last couple reactions I did of Ian Anderson, it was just the solo. So there really wasn't much integration with the rest of the band. And here you get to hear that integration. And I really like it. It sounds really cool. I think that's what drew a lot of people. Like, obviously, Ian Anderson is a fantastic flute player, and the things that he can do soloistically are just, it's hard stuff to do. You can't just pick up a flute. Well, I guess Ian can just pick up a flute and start doing it. Most people can't just pick up a flute and start doing that. But for Ian, he obviously could, because he did. I saw a lot of, like, the F sharp with the middle finger. You know, I'm going to be that flute player. And I say this in all joking. Like, that's like a saxophone fingering for F sharp. Flute players do use it. It's usually for trills and really, really fast passages. But that's just, like, one of those little, like, as a flute player, I'm just going to point it out. He does a lot of the middle F sharp. Overall, it sounds fine. It can have a slightly not as clear tone as with the ring finger for your F sharp, but it's just one of those things that I'm just going to point out as, like, a self-taught flutist. Yeah, it's just one of those things that I want to point out for fun. Obviously, it does not affect the performance at all. It's just something I noticed. But again, he's standing on one foot while doing all of this, so it doesn't matter. It's just, it's fun to point out, because, like, here we have a really nice clean shot of his fingering. So as a flute player, I can actually, like, watch his fingerings and, like, kind of see what he does. I like it. And yeah, he's going between the E and the F sharp a lot. So yeah, we're having, like, those dual tones. We have a lot of this buzzing. We have, like, this singing while playing, kind of going back and forth between all everything. And it's just a really cool effect. Like I said, you're seeing a lot more contemporary pieces with some of this extended technique, but you just didn't really see a whole lot of it in, like, the traditional classical way. Maybe a little bit here and there, kind of with the dual tones. You've seen a little bit in classical stuff, but not, like, nearly to the extent that Ian Anderson uses it. I just want to point out again, like, that stuff is not easy to do. Let me rephrase. It's easy to do, but hard to make it sound really good. So it's one of those things, and I feel like that's just been a metaphor for most of my life, you know, learning some of this new stuff. It's easy to learn how to do it. It's really hard to perfect it. And this is exactly here. And I'm only bringing that up because I'll leave a link to the live stream I did where I was learning BLS and Breath of the Wild, where the trick to doing it is really easy, but getting to it to do what you want it to do is the hard thing. And I love when I see, like, these things between, like, video game and music. That's my two loves combined. So there's a lot to talk about right here. I really like how he went from, like, the extended technique to, like, just more classical flute playing, just playing the flute. I really like that. I have not heard much of him just, like, with a straight flute tone. A lot of it has been, like, the extended techniques and stuff. So to hear him just play with a straight flute tone, it's refreshing. It adds, like, again, a different dimension. It gives your ears a little bit of a break from, like, with the extended technique, there's so much going on. There's so much, like, sound and different nuances to it that, like, it can feel jumbled almost. So when he goes to, like, just the straight flute tone and is just playing, it adds another layer to the song, and it, like, adds another, it's kind of like a break for your ears. Like, you're just now listening to a beautiful flute sound. And this just shows the complexity, and it shows the, what's the word I'm looking for? It shows the diversity. It shows the diversity of flute and what the flute can actually do, that you don't just have to hear it in stuffy classical settings, that there's so much beauty and so much that can be done with it. And yeah, I'm enjoying watching his fingering. I see him play an A with, like, the first two and then adding this, and I wonder if his reasoning behind it, I wonder if it just kind of adds a different, I'm gonna have to try that. just to experiment between the A and putting that first down. Normally you would kind of see that kind of what's called a cross fingering just to help with tone in certain notes and in certain instruments. And like certain specific flutes in particular, sometimes will have like those, you'll want to those cross fingerings to get a different effect from the note you're playing. So I'm curious if that's exactly what he's doing here. Because I always like to say, I like to tell my flute students that flute players are lazy, that we don't want to have to work harder than we need to. So using more fingers if we don't need to is something we try to avoid as a flute player and as an instrumentalist. But there are times where you want to do stuff like that because it does improve the tone quality or if it, you're trying to do a specific effect. So I'd be interested to know if that A fingering with the first finger down on the right hand did something. I'm going to have to experiment with that myself. And then like that, ooh, that pinky work, that. So I know I mentioned in, I think, my first Jethro Tull reaction that he didn't use his pinky a lot. And we talked about, like, it's not really necessary, but, like, a classical flute teacher will, like, stress how much to use that pinky. And I know people have mentioned that he either was born with a defect or something happened to his pinky. I've seen both. As to why he doesn't use it a whole lot. Doing like those lower notes with the pinky. There are specific pinky exercise workouts and a lot of flute method books to work on doing that because your pinky is a very weak finger for the most part. It doesn't like to move by itself. Like even here, you can see my ring finger is kind of moving with it. It's a little bit easier when you have your grip on the flute itself. But like getting your pinky to do what you want between the different notes. And it looks like he just has a C flute. I'll have to watch in the video to see if he has a full, if he has a B foot or if he just has a C foot on his flute. That only changes the number of keys that are, that you can use on the pinky. But yeah, doing those pinky workouts, like to get those low notes that fast and clean requires a lot of just pinky work. So I wanted to stop here to mention just like I like how he is like playing and then like making some vocal noises, almost like a chimpanzee, like a monkey. I don't understand why, but I like that the fact that he's doing that. Again, when you have just a solo instrument, there's nothing else going on in the background, having these little vocalizations just add some dimension to the song and it gives it more than just the flute sound. It kind of makes it feel like a full song, even though you're just playing by yourself. And then, yeah, the crotch grab, you know what? He's a rocker. It's the 70s. I'm not surprised, but I wasn't expecting it. It's just it's just so seamless how he's like going between playing and vocalizing, and a lot of the times he's doing it at the same time, but when he has like these hits of vocalization and playing, it's just so seamless, and that is so hard to do. It's so hard to do that when you're even just playing straight, but to add the vocalization and sound it all sound cohesive and together, and it's hard. It is hard. And anyone who says that, you know, rock musicians aren't real musicians, just, I don't know what to tell you. This is stuff that is taught at the college level and that takes time to master. It's not easy. And the fact that he is just self-taught and picked it up and just tried to, and just learned how to play it and is this good, is this prolific, is, it's amazing. So yeah, if you don't like this type of music, that's one thing, but to like for classical musicians to disparage rock musicians because it's not classical, it's not proper, is just ridiculous. Because as a flute player, and I've tried to do some of these extended techniques, it is not easy. Ha ha ha! It's so hard to find a good spot to stop. He does a lot of standing on one foot. I'm curious as to why. Is it just because it's the showmanship? Is it to just show off that he can? Because again, balancing on one foot while playing the flute, which like I mentioned earlier, is a very temperamental instrument that any movements from your face can go from a beautiful flute sound to no flute sound. So it's a very temperamental instrument in that way. And the fact that he's just doing this on one foot as if it's nothing, it's just, wow. Wow. But yeah, I'm curious as to why he does it a whole lot. And if the answer is because he can, I mean, that's completely valid. I guess if I could do it, I'd probably do it more, but I don't do live performances, so I really don't have a need to practice that. And I love how, like, even with this vocalization, he's getting a lot of dynamic range. And again, that's difficult to do. It's one thing to, you know, vocalize and play, but to get dynamic range in it, again, is just a lot more work. It's a lot more training. It's really hard to do. And I like the key slaps. Again, you're starting to see this more in contemporary flute repertoire, but, you know, those key slaps give you different tones when you slap different notes, and it just kind of adds like this percussive beatboxing quality to it. Nothing that I've really employed in any of my music. I've never really had the occasion to, and it's a really cool effect, and it's just so cool to see it like in a rock band. It just shows the diversity of the flute. And then how can you not hear that and just laugh and like just appreciate the child nature of it? Like you gotta just appreciate the child nature. And again, he didn't really play any of that. He just key slapped it all. And it's just, it's cute. It's fun. It's quirky. It makes for such a good performance. Yeah. There we go with the pinky again. And yeah, he does have a C flute. That's not a big deal. I mean, it's more, can you play the low B or can you only go to C? Not a huge deal. It is not indicative of the quality of the flute either. It's kind of regional as to whether or not in Europe, having just a C flute is very common. More in the US, having the B foot. Like going down, you can go one note lower to the low B is a lot more popular. It's just a matter of where you live and what's available. It does not indicate the quality of the flute. So yeah, I was just more my own curiosity. But yeah, that again, with that pinky workout, it is. That, oh man, many a time with that etude. Ever the showman. Love it. Kicking while playing. Again, not easy to do. He makes it look easy. I love that really low buzz hum up into the high note. That is just so cool. That is such a cool effect. I really like it. That's all I had to say. I just really like that. That sounded so cool. And those trills were clean. Loved it. And then back in with the rest of the group. So here, I like the whole band playing. Okay. So this is something different that in this song than the other two Jethro Tull reactions I've done to date, is the fact that we're not just focusing on the solo. We're hearing like how the flute incorporates with the rest of the band. And I really like that. It just, flutes in non-traditional settings just make my little nerdy heart happy because I tend to do flute in non-traditional settings. I have done a piece called Time to Say Goodbye from the anime Ruby. I will leave a link to the song up in the cards where, you know, it's flute with traditionally rock and roll instruments. And I love stuff like that because the flute works with it. I really like here that we get to get a piece of him playing with the full band and how, like, it just adds a really cool quality. It adds a whole different color to the rest of the ensemble that you just don't really hear very often. I love it. And here I like that, you know, we're getting more of just like the traditional flute and piano with some other backing instruments. You know, you get to hear more of just his straight flute playing, which up until this point I have not heard a whole lot of. And I just really like the way it sounds. I like his technique. I like, you know, the runs he's doing. I like what he's playing. It's just, it sounds really cool. And it's just, it's cool to hear, like, as much as I enjoyed the extended technique, it's cool to hear just like the straight flute and Ian's take on it within this setting. And yeah, this song has just offered a lot of like really simple stuff to like really full, complex, full band stuff. And then kind of like, again, back to this more simple stuff. And it just gives the whole song like so much dimension, so much variety all within one song. And it's just so enjoyable to listen to. You don't really feel bored. You don't feel like you're listening to the same thing over and over and over, which I feel like a lot of pop music today can sound like, where it's like the same thing over and over and over, especially if there's like a catchy chorus. They'll repeat it over and over and over. And here, like, this song just has so much movement, so much story to it, and I really enjoy it.
And the graven image Catholic with his plastic crucifix. How you get it, I think?
Just so much showmanship. I love it. The background, like even the rest of the band, they're not background performance, the rest of the band, so much showmanship. And right here, we're having like now another transition where, you know, we're having that cymbal really start going and it's about to pick up again. Ian is like all over the place. It's such good showmanship. It's such a good performance. And again, like the song kind of covers the gamut, and it gives you so much to listen for. Again with the twirling. And then right there, it drops into kind of like this almost like smooth jazz feel, like with a very like just light cymbal and like a nice little bass line with it and just a little bit of electric guitar to round it out. But it just like has like this high energy, and then it just drops into like this very smooth stuff, and Ian's just playing the flute and I'm here for it. So before we get into the soul, I really think that I have not seen any of Roland Kirk, but people have mentioned that that Ian was heavily influenced by Roland Kirk. I do plan on checking Roland Kirk out. I have not yet. I will definitely do some reactions to it. I can see, if I remember correctly, someone had mentioned that Roland Kirk was a jazz flute player. If I'm remembering correctly, I could be wrong when I'm saying that. But if that is the case, I can definitely see where Ian would have gotten that influence in this section, because it's a very jazz flute-esque vibe to it. And it's a jazz flute is a whole nother ball game. I do not play jazz flute. I can't really play jazz. I just don't have much of a jazzy bone in my body. But like, you can concentrate on playing jazz flute in school, because it's like, yeah, there's flute playing and there's jazz flute playing, because it comes with its own very specific like rules and techniques and stuff that you don't really see in classical, and it gives it a whole different vibe, and that just shows how much the flute can actually do. All right, now let's dive into the solo. Again with the pinky. Ugh. It's not easy. Most pinkies don't want to move like that. So again, with the dynamic range with this, it's really impressive to really get that much of a dynamic range with what is considered an extended technique now. Again, that just takes a lot of practice. It's so hard to do, but it's so effective when well done. I love how even the band members are amused by this. So it looked to me that he was holding the B-flat gizmo while he was doing that. And again, I'm kind of curious, like, I want to try this in the practice room to see, like, what kind of effect that is having on the sound. And if that is, like, kind of helping getting, like, this buzzing vocalized quality to it. And I love that, you know, this camera angle allows us, at least for me as a flute player, to really see what he's doing with his hands, to kind of like look out for, like looking out for specific things. And yeah, it's interesting. I definitely want to see if I can try it out a bit. Again, I love like that low, like almost throat singing quality before he goes like running up to the high note. So I love that effect. It's such a cool effect. And again, the kicking on the one foot, it's just... it's just so well done. Final thoughts. I think it was well done. I really liked the song because it had Ian playing guitar, which I had not seen up until this point, and just shows that he's a fantastic guitar player. At least I think so. But then again, I know nothing of guitar. I know I am not a string instrument player. So I know I can't speak on, you know, the technique of that, but I think it sounded great, and that's all that really matters to an audience member. He played guitar really well. I like how we had the flute with the band, we had the flute solo, there was extended technique, there was just straight playing, we had that childish quality when he was doing the key slaps playing. So it covered everything. I really enjoyed it. It's a great performance. I'd be interested to hear what this song sounds like in the studio. You know, I love a good live performance. So thank you all for watching. I hope you enjoyed this reaction and analysis. If this kind of content interests you, please consider like, sharing, and subscribing, doing all the YouTube things that really helps my channel. If you are so inclined, please consider becoming a patron over on patreon.com/KatieShesko or making a one-time donation via Ko-fi. Your donations really help support my channel and my content. And again, if you can't donate, like I said, just like, share, subscribe, leaving a comment below really helps my channel as well. Follow me on all my social media. Links will be in the description below. If you have any suggestions as to what you would like to see me react to next, again, leave a comment below. I write down all of your suggestions. It's greatly appreciated because I want to know what you want to see from me. That is all I have for this video. I hope you have a fantastic rest of your day, and I will catch you in the next one. Bye.